and welcome to OT Over Easy. My name is Becca, and today we are continuing our talk about splints. This is part three of the series, and we are going to delve a little bit more into thumbs. In part two, we did talk about median nerve injuries, which does touch on thumbs a little bit, so if you're looking for that, go check out part two. But otherwise, we are going to be talking about, in this one, splinting for DeQuervain's tenosynovitis, CMC arthritis, and skier's / gamekeeper's thumb. So let's crack on. DeQuervain's tenosynovitis is a big scary word with not so scary of a splint. Let's quickly remind ourselves what the condition is. A tenosynovitis is an irritation of a tendon as it passes back and forth within a tendon sheath. And DeQuervain's tenosynovitis is specifically that happening at the first dorsal compartment. Lies right about here in your wrist, and it's where your abductor pollicis longus and your extensor pollicis brevis run together within the same sheath. So it's angry tendons right around here. Conservative management of this condition involves rest to allow irritation and inflammation to come down in that area. So because of its placement in the wrist and because it's involving tendons that move the thumb, we want a brace that is going to immobilize the wrist and the thumb. And that may look something like this. This here is what I would call a forearm-based thumb spica. We've mentioned in our past videos, a thumb spica is a splint that provides support to the thumb. Hand-based would leave the wrist free and only cover the hand. Forearm-based crosses the wrist and includes that forearm, so it immobilizes the wrist as well. This is a custom thermoplastic hard brace. You could also use a soft over-the-counter brace. The most important thing is that it is, again, crossing the wrist, but also supporting the thumb. It is not good enough to just have a brace that covers the wrist. Sometimes, because the pain is here, patients will come in and just get a wrist brace without the thumb included, but that doesn't do them any good because that thumb is still moving, those tendons are still rubbing. So it must include the base of the thumb here. You can leave the tip joint of the thumb free because the extensor pollicis longus, which comes out and extends the tip of the thumb, that is a different tendon. It runs in a different sheath. So the tip is free, but the base of the thumb, so that extensor pollicis brevis and that abductor pollicis longus, can rest. Easy like that. While we're talking about allowing structures to rest and be protected, let's talk about gamekeeper's thumb and skier's thumb. Both of these conditions are injuries to the ulnar collateral ligament of the thumb MCP joint, so your supporting ligament on the side, right about here. The difference between the two is that skier's thumb is an acute injury, named so because if you're skiing and you have a ski pole stick and it jams into you, pull the thumb back, it can injure that ligament. Versus the gamekeeper's thumb is more of a chronic, over time, repetitive issue that damages that ligament because of handling tools and squeezing and things like that. Again, having the thumb repetitively pulled back like this. Either way, it's the UCL, again, that ulnar collateral ligament right here at the MCP of the thumb. We're going to splint it the same either way. For this one, I would probably choose a hand-based thumb spica. The most important thing is essentially immobilization of that MCP, and most importantly within that, we're protecting it from being yanked back and forth in this direction. Again, if our injury is a ligament right here, we want to hold that thumb in a protected position so that it's not going to be moving around, it's not going to be pulling that ligament out away from where it inserts. It's going to be nice and stable in a splint like this. So this is that hand-based thumb spica. Again, a forearm-based thumb spica crosses the wrist, hand-based thumb spica does not, and it allows for movement of the wrist. Unlike the DeQuervain's tenosynovitis, which involves crossing the wrist, this is all in the thumb, so you don't need that wrist immobilized. We just need to protect the thumb. So for skier's thumb and gamekeeper's thumb, this is what we're looking for. So now for CMC arthritis. So CMC is going to be our joint at the base of the thumb down here. Let's think about the purpose of a splint for a CMC arthritis. Unlike the DeQuervain's and the skier's or gamekeeper's thumb, arthritis is not typically a condition that we expect to heal per se, right? It's a degenerative change of the joint surfaces, and no amount of immobilization is going to change that. It's not going to magically make those surfaces go smooth again. So we're not looking to cure the condition. What we are looking to do is decrease pain and increase function. Because of that, we have actually quite a lot of options for CMC arthritis, depending on what the patient's needs are. Different people may respond better to hard plastic versus a nice, soft, flexible splint. Or depending on what activities they're doing, they may want something that can get wet. They may not care about that. They may need something small enough to fit inside of a glove. Some people might want something larger and bulkier and more protective. But generally speaking, you're going to be looking at some sort of thumb support, either a thumb spica like this, or it might even be a little bit smaller. This one here is immobilizing my MCP joint, but they may have enough support from something that looks a little bit more like this. This is called a Colditz style brace, named after the therapist Judy Colditz, who designed it. This one, you can see my MCP is free, but it still supports just the CMC joint. Unlike for the UCL injury, we need to immobilize that MCP, right? We need to protect it from these sideways forces. But with an arthritis, some people may want that joint supported. That may feel better. Others may be just fine in something a little bit lower profile like this. But in most CMC arthritis cases, you're going to want something that is going to support the CMC joint. So it's going to be either immobilizing or limiting the motion specifically at that joint. The other thing a lot of them are going to be trying to achieve is stopping the MCP joint from going into hyperextension. So because of the way CMC arthritis degrades the joints down here, your first metacarpal here will often start to drift like this, and that will result both in developing a kind of a more bony prominence at the base of the thumb here. That's called a shoulder sign, and that's from the bottom of the bone kicking out. And then from that top of the bone kicking in, that thumb may develop a posture that involves hyperextension of that MCP joint. And between those two things happening, it just throws off the typical balance and biomechanics of how the thumb usually distributes loads across the three joints. And it causes a lot of pain. So our splint, in addition to providing support down here, wants to help kind of hug the thumb backwards like this, so that that MCP cannot hyperextend. So you can see in this brace here, I can kind of hyperextend a little bit, but I am supported somewhat from doing that. If you have someone who has lots and lots of laxity at that MCP joint and they are bending way back, perhaps something like that isn't quite gonna cut it. So you want something that comes up and blocks that MCP joint a little bit more. So this is where I get into saying you have to think about what your specific patient needs. But generally speaking, again, for an entry-level exam, just know that for CMC arthritis, you're going to be looking at some sort of thumb brace generally that supports that MCP joint, and it may exclude the MCP. Did I say CMC earlier? I can't remember. Editing Becca will find out for me. This is editing Becca, and I did indeed goof up. You want it to for sure support the CMC joint, and it may or may not also support more extensively the MCP joint. CMC, MCP. Back to past Becca. And that's it for thumbs. Short and sweet on this one. If you have any questions about anything we've talked about in this video, or have other splints you'd like to see in future videos, please drop them in the comments below. But otherwise, thanks for hanging out with me today. Keep an eye out for the other splinting videos that are coming. And I hope this one made understanding splints a little more easy. Happy studying! A tenosynovitis is an irritation of a tendon as it passes back and forth